Coffee drinkers, what's happening? I got something to show you. I'm getting ready to move house, which is really exciting. And with the emptying of my storage unit the other day with Chelsea, I came across a huge box of music books that I hadn't seen in so long. And when I saw it, it really made me think about like what I used to do with these books, with all of these real books. Like I remember getting, of course, the first thing to go is the cover on this one and the first couple of pages of index, but this was like the illegal, the old real book. And this is a bass clef version. I remember getting this when I was in Berkeley, going up to the store and kind of getting it under the table, like 20 years ago or more, whenever that was. This was before iPods even existed. So this is definitely pre-iPhone, pre-Massimo's iRealB app. And that used to come with me to a lot of jam sessions. And whenever I needed to learn a tune really quickly for a jam session, I needed to read it, that tune that I didn't know. My best friend Antonio got me this and got it signed by Pat as well. And it's just kind of cool. Huge resource of compositions of someone obviously I'm way, way into. But before I got to the States, when I was, you know, when I was still living in England and when I was practicing and working on my sight reading and trying to get my sight reading together for the bass, I would grab these, the new real books. I have tons of them. Actually, the Latin real book, like you name it. One here called The World's Greatest Fake Book. Same kind of thing, same kind of layout. Chuck Scher, music, Scher, Scher, Scher. I don't know how you pronounce that. But I used to grab these and just pick out any tune, you know, like, I haven't seen this in a long time. Like, here's a Yellow Jackets tune, for instance, Freedom Land, which I kind of know this tune, so it's cheating a little bit, but that would be my thing. Like, I didn't have Spotify going on in like 1996 or 97. So I would grab the cassette. Like, I probably had a cassette tape of this. I don't know how well you're gonna be able to hear that. You know, and I would just read the chart down. That really, really helped me with my reading and just awareness of form, like all of these kind of things that I got out of books. There's always that question of like, how much should you read out of books? You know, especially transcription books. You know, I'm a massive fan of not learning material from transcription books, even though I do own, I found in here a couple of transcription books. I think because I'd done so many of these transcriptions myself, I wanted to kind of compare it to like the official version. I did get the Michael Brecker transcription book by Carl Cohen, but it was just interesting to look at how you know, how it was officially notated, and so many great solos in here that I transcribed. Not Ethiopia, for instance, from the Brecker brothers. I transcribed Etch-a-Sketch. It's Been Real. This one with the violin on it, which was amazing. And it was just great to see how, you know, those crazy kind of wall of sound elements of what, you know, I guess Coltrane did really first, and what Brecker kind of took over there. Like, there'd be passages like that where it's like totally crazy. And in terms of my like notation and learning notation, it was really helpful to have transcribed that first, done all the, you know, the heavy lifting, done all the work myself, and then kind of compare it to whatever the official version. I guess this was sanctioned by Mike and given the okay, and a 10 over 2, a 9 over 2, and like all of these groupings of notes. It was really interesting to see that written down. So a fun thing to get, interesting to read, but definitely not the source of the information. So I don't recommend doing it that way around at all. I don't recommend getting the book and learning the solo out of the book. Always recommend doing the work yourself. So that question comes up a lot. Like, what do you use books for? What are good books to use? You guys have heard me talk about the Hannon Virtuoso Pianist a lot. That was like my one kind of technique book that I used. I have some things. Like, I found this, the Simandl, like 30 etudes for string bass. Yeah, like, I should probably, like, I haven't looked at these in years. I should probably kind of read through them. This is great for your reading chops, just going in cold, reading something you've never read before. Quarter note is 112. I guess that's somewhere around there. Awesome. Maybe I'm going to put that to the side and kind of go over some of this stuff, because it's all in bass clef. It's not too complicated, and it's great if I want to keep my reading in shape. So there's all kinds of stuff. This manual, what is this? Manual of Scales, Arpeggios, and Broken Chords. This is more of a piano book. It's on two staves. You know, that was, I kind of got that after the Hannon, thinking, oh, another piano book, that'll be awesome. And then I don't really think, as beat up as this is actually, I don't really think I used it that much, but obviously it's still in there. But really the getting inside the music, like I did a ton of work, obviously, learning songs and learning parts from listening. But then with the reading thing and being able to read in treble clef and being able to read a B flat chart, you know, being able to transpose at sight. I think that's one of the great things about the Mike Brecker thing. That really helped me when I would read some of the things along with the solo, but written, this is in B flat, this is for the tenor saxophone, this is not in concert. It really gave me that understanding of reading, transposing at sight. And that's something that horn players do all the time. Like most horn players get given concert charts all the time and have to transpose to B flat or to E flat if you're an alto player. So that was great to do it this way around. Not only reading in another clef, the treble clef, but transposing at sight. So although I don't recommend getting the information out of this, the actual notes and the solos out of a transcription book like this, they can be really useful for a ton of other things. And they were for me. And there have been certain times, not many times, but certain times where that information and that ability, that technique came in very useful. You know, being given a B flat chart and saying, hey man, and even if it was just changes, just being able to know to read down or read up or whichever way you're transposing, whichever key the chart is in. And also living in New York and the few gigs I did do in New York with singers and playing standards and stuff like that, being able to transpose immediately or play tunes in multiple keys or maybe even have a chart, be handed a chart, be handed the real book even for a song, but then be told, okay, we're doing this in C sharp. Originally it's in B flat, but we're doing it in D flat, C sharp, and it's everything up a minor third. So I think I got a lot of that kind of practice out of these books. And then different styles, you know, Latin music wasn't something I knew too much about, like right in the beginning, especially Afro-Cuban music. I knew way more about Brazilian music because of Ayrton Flora right in the beginning of my career than I did about Afro-Cuban music. So this was great sight reading practice and just notated bass lines, you know, like, and really not so much learning the bass lines from here, more reading them, but also going through this book not knowing what to listen to, not having like an Afro-Cuban aficionado like Chelsea is by my side telling me, oh, you should listen to this, or this is cool, or if you want to improve your salsa playing, like this is the thing to listen to. So that was great. That was a nice little detour to get that Latin real book and to play a bunch of music. Way later, like after I moved to LA, I ended up playing a bunch of kind of Latin gigs, salsa gigs, that kind of stuff, and Latin jazz gigs, for which there were a ton of chants in there. So that was awesome, like preparing for those gigs, they ended up surfacing in here. And then I have, like with a lot of these books, like a ton of loose leaf charts in the front that kind of pertain to Latin, Afro-Cuban, and Brazilian music. So that's kind of how, a real ghetto way of how I organize my stuff. I stuff it in the front of the book. But one interesting thing I will say about my process with that and kind of the way I've used a lot of these books was that I was always way more engaged with the music and having way more fun and being able to take so much more in and learn so much more from the situation when I was away from any of this stuff. Okay, so it's always been really important for me to learn the material. You know, there are some great resources here. I think there are great resources everywhere. These just happen to be a few of the books I have and found in this box, but there are great resources all over the place. But really learning the music ahead of time, as long as you have the time, is huge. And you know, when I remember getting this book, like the Brecker Brothers kind of songbook, like with a lot of the parts and the horn parts and the arrangements and the chords, all this stuff, you know, being able to, wanting to play these tunes years and years and years and years ago, like before I even went to Berkeley, I remember getting this book. And then finally, when I came to play with Randy Brecker and play like a ton of these tunes, it was so much about learning that material because it's really quite complex, you know? And the more I had committed to memory, the more fun those gigs were. I mean, I remember the first couple of gigs I played with Randy and it was like pretty full on and I had all of the music for all of the tunes. And I slowly just whittled it down until I probably only needed one or two of the more really dense and complex charts, or perhaps songs we didn't play as often on the stand. And I could do most of the rest of the gig from memory, you know, playing like Strap Hanging and Skunk Funk and all of those like classic Brecker Brothers tunes. It was so much more fun like that. So I highly recommend getting away from all of this stuff as quickly as possible. Can't recommend that enough. And as I'm thinking about that, I'm working on yet another book right now. This is going to be All the Good Stuff, Volume 2. Just another huge resource of information and concepts to populate your practice routine with, because it's something that's constantly changing for me. Although there are some staples, like some of the Hannon things I developed and kind of adapted for the bass. Kind of that pattern-based thing in groups of four, major, minor, diminished, that kind of thing. And of course, that thing that I came up with years and years ago, I'm always developing new ones because I'll just lose my mind if I carry on with just that. I'll go totally crazy. So I came up with one the other day. I put a little thing on Instagram where I was working, was it on? I think it was on like the half diminished thing. Kind of going 5-1. And then after I filmed that little video, put it on Instagram, I went back to my practice routine. And I was working on a chromatic approach note beneath each chord tone. On the one minor. And I was like, well, hang on, what if I split that up and I skip one? I'll show you what I mean. That what I came up with was this. So instead of going straight up the sequence on each chord tone, I skipped one and then came back down to it. So instead of going from the root to the third to the fifth, I went from the root to the fifth, down to the third, to the root, to the fifth, the third, the root, the fifth, the third, the root, the fifth, the third, the root. And then came straight back down, minor arpeggio, adding the ninth each time. Which turned into something, you know, that I can move around the instrument. Could be a great warm-up thing. I don't know, it's definitely a good dexterity thing. And really good to have it in all 12 keys, of course. And maybe play around like cycle of fizz. That's a good one. And I'm pretty much picking every single note with the right hand for kind of that discipline's sake and for the fundamentals and the foundation of the exercise. I haven't got it into a super high tempo where I need to figure out hammers and pulls yet in the left hand. But that is what I'm constantly doing throughout my career, throughout my life, throughout my musical kind of exploration and curiosity, is always developing new things like that to improve my technique and to improve my understanding of music and of harmony in general. So it's like March towards Christmas. I mean, that's kind of the goal I'm setting myself, is to have All the Good Stuff Part 2 out by Christmas. I think that would be an awesome goal. Then I can take a little bit of a vacation with Chelsea and just like, you know, switch off for a few days. So that's kind of the goal right now. And it's these kind of things that I'm putting in it. And I'm really psyched about it. It was great to find all of these books and kind of draw some inspiration from that and just remember what my process was with all of these books and how I would sit there for hours, get countless hours, so many hours that I would just lose track of time, lose track of days of the week sometimes, like I talked about yesterday with the sheer volume of hours that I put in with the instrument. So that's where I'm at right now. That's what I'm inspired to be doing, is sharing all of these new exercises and ideas in a book form with you guys. And I'll show you them as I come across them in the vlog, of course, and compile all that and put it together. Christmas is the goal. Let's see if we can nail that. But for now, I kind of have two things. That one I just showed you, like the chromatic approach note thing. And then I'm working on some half diminished ideas as well. And I'm not sure what I'm doing with the half diminished thing. Right now I'm just getting it fluent where I'm going up and down basically. And then I want to add in maybe a 5-to-1 idea. And all the places you can go to one, like how you think of the half diminishes of five and all of the different ones that you can have. So that was kind of... D7 to G, G minor. And then we could go... We could go F7 to B flat minor. That would be a fun one. And then maybe A flat 7 to C sharp minor. Something like that, and then it'll go around. There are basically three different places you can think about it. But anyway, that's my process. That's what I'm working on right now. I will continue to share that with you guys on the vlog. And a quick note, we have like in a few days, like or two or three days time, it's gonna be 100 final days of the vlog. The last 100 days. We're gonna hit vlog 265 in a couple of days, and then it will be 100 days until the end of the vlog and the end of this planned vlog project, 365 days consecutively. So let's try and do like some huge ones. I want suggestions of maybe people you want to see interviewed or musical situations that you have suggestions for. I'm open to anything. So let me know. There are going to be some really fun ones and some cool stuff happening for sure that I already have planned, but let's try and fill the last 100 days with some just ridiculously great stuff. Stuff that everyone can get something out of and stuff that the people will really enjoy, stuff that you will enjoy watching and want to come back and watch it again. So have a think about that. Leave me comments below this video, comments, questions, suggestions, all of that stuff. Today's vlog is done. We'll see you guys tomorrow. Thank you.